Here's the thing, architectural renderings and drawings in general usually take a long time to make. And to make YouTube videos out of them, unfortunately, I need to skip some parts and focus on the moves that matter. The steps that I feel will bring the most value to you when you watch the video. But this time I decided to go back to the basics. I'm taking a simple elevation drawing that could have been made in any CAD or BIM software and stylizing it, or rendering it, if you call it like that, in Photoshop. No steps skipped this time, and you'll learn it all under 10 minutes or so, as you saw in the title. If you're a beginner in Photoshop, this video will teach you a useful workflow to handle most types of architectural drawings in Photoshop. But if you're already an intermediate or advanced user, don't worry, there are a few moves here that I'm pretty sure will benefit you too. You'll probably go like, oh, is it possible to do it this way too? Or even something like, I usually take a lot more time to achieve the same result. That's interesting to know. And if by the end of this video you have a workflow or a move that's way better than what I'm doing, be sure to leave it in the comments below, so not only I can learn from you, but also other students can see your process. So let's begin. And as always, timestamps are available, so if you want to skip ahead or rewatch something, it's easy to do that. Now, this video is sponsored by Milanote, and since I'm covering everything in this video, I thought it would be really interesting to show a step of the process that I usually don't share with you guys, which is reference searching. Now, Milanote is a tool for organizing creative projects, and as architects, we're always gathering inspirations, combining ideas with coworkers, and developing solutions based on photos, drawings, and images. And this exchange of information is often scattered throughout emails, WhatsApp, folders on your computer, and so on. So I was excited to have Milanote on this video and share with you guys, because it's a digital place where you can do all of that, a whiteboard to unload all of your creative thinking. And I find it very useful to gather references, for example, sort of like a mood board of the image I'm about to create. Honestly, no image ever starts without this step, but it's always off camera. And this time I decided to share with you. So today we're gonna work with this elevation here, and I'm thinking sort of like a minimal slash collage style. So let's create a new board. And now I could start with a template, which can be helpful, but I'm looking for an empty canvas this time. Now it's as simple as dragging the images you have on your computer to the board. But even more magical and useful is just to right-click something you saw online, copy, and then paste it here. There's even a browser plugin to help with that, but like for me, copying and pasting directly is the quickest. There are loads of interesting features here, but I like to use the color card to pick colors from existing images here and find the color palette I'll be referring to when I'm creating my images. I can add comments, other ideas as bullet points, and even to-dos. You do have total creative freedom here. Like, I find it very useful to structure project ideas, like video and course ideas. For example, the isometric diagrams masterclass and what I would cover in each lesson. I hope you found this part useful, as I always try to partner up with brands that can bring value to my audience. So thanks Milanote for sponsoring this video. And after reference searching and getting inspired, let's dive into Photoshop. Now, most likely you'll get to this first stage with the base PDF file. Depending on where you exported the drawing, it can come rotated too. But assuming you export it up to scale and with the line thickness correct, you're good to go. Simply drag and drop into Photoshop and it will open as a new file. You will have the same dimensions you set back in CAD or BIM, so keep that in mind. Here I'm just viewing it in pixels, but make sure to choose Crop to Media Box to maintain the overall canvas boundary. Now, no background, no problem. Just create a new layer and fill it with white. Then drag it below the drawing. To rotate the entire canvas here in Photoshop, go to Image, Image Rotation, and choose the correct direction, in my case here, 90 degrees counterclockwise. Listen, the key to a non-destructive workflow that will allow you to work efficiently and make any changes or experiment with different results easily is to name and categorize your file. Just double-click on the layer name to change it, then right-click on the visibility eye to choose a color. Now let's start working with the textures first. Create a new layer and group it, that's Ctrl-G. Creatively, you're free to use any textures you'd like by this point, but I'm going for the classic paper texture. It's subtle, but adds a bit of detail to the surface. Then we're going to work non-destructively as always. Instead of deleting or erasing parts we don't want, we'll use a mask. And the fastest way to do it is to use a magic wand with the base layer selected. Then left-click once inside the area you want to select. Plain and simple. After that, using this current selection, select the texture layer and click on the mask. This creates the mask with the current selection so that it knows what to reveal and what not to. And pro tip here, if you hold Alt when clicking on the mask button, it creates the inverse of what you have selected, and this can come in handy in many situations, and I use it very often in my workflow. Now, once you have the structure set up, you can easily add or remove other parts, like this pillar here, for example. And this is it for textures. Like, no matter how large or small your elevation section is, the process of adding textures is the same. But here's a catch. Not always you're going to use the entire texture, right? Sometimes you need to stack it up to fill an area, and for that you will need seamless textures. So when you copy them against each other, there are no visible seams. Now, we recently created a new post-production texture pack. It contains 100 textures for you to get started with your library. This is already the third volume, and you guys seem to really like the first and second volumes. As always, it has a very affordable price tag for the number of high quality assets you get. And this is a way you can also support the work that we do here. Packs are one of the ways we can maintain the channel running and posting free content here on YouTube. I'm gonna leave some links down in the video description if you're interested. Now back to the texture, if you hold Alt when dragging, you can quickly make a copy. Then I like to merge it all so that I've got one single texture layer. Select the layers and hit Ctrl E. But now listen really careful, this is one of the only occasions I use merge. Unless it's a situation like this where it won't affect the non-destructive structure that much, I would stay away from merging, honestly. Okay, then it's the usual process. And now the trick about adding textures that look good together is playing with the strength, or contrast if you will, of each texture. But my tip here is not to simply lower the opacity, or else if you add something as a background or overlay other textures, it may show through and give you more work in the end. So my suggestion is use the adjustment layers, window adjustments. Clipped as always so that it only affects the current layer. And here I'm using levels, but curves would also work similarly. And use the sliders to brighten the image, but without adding any contrast. This knob here does exactly what we need. Perfect. I'm gonna add a thicker ground line here by hand. This is optional, as it usually comes correctly done from your CAD or BIM, but I wanted to have this hand-drawn feel in the areas that had no slabs. And same goes for cut fills. And it obviously depends on the project, right? So after adding all the remaining textures, let's talk about shadows. Look, I know you can export shadows from a BIM software and it will come very precise, but sometimes those shadow shapes can be a bit distracting. And doing this here, whether in Photoshop or Illustrator, will allow you to be more minimal about it. And it's quite easy to do, honestly. Just create a new layer and clip it to the texture layer. And I'm doing one layer for each shadow so that it's easier to manage, but also doing like this means that we don't have to be that careful and we can go over the boundaries. Let me show you. With the rectangular selection tool, I can draw these weird shapes here, which in essence covers exactly where I need it to cover. But I don't need to be that precise over the lines and edges. Then Alt backspace to fill the selection using the foreground color. Not that difficult, isn't it? Now we just gotta repeat for every volume here, according to the project, of course. And the strength or intensity of that shadow can be set by lowering the layer opacity this time. Custom shapes are easier to do with the polygonal lasso tool in my experience. And now it's starting to look interesting, right? So let's continue. Next up is the trees. Look, there are a million possible ways to add trees. The easiest is by using brushes. It may take longer to set it up at first, but once you're into this stage, it makes things a lot faster. And as you saw in the title, I'm giving away this brush for free. Just go to the link in the video description to check it out. And importing into Photoshop takes no time really. Just hit B for the brush tool, then right click and go to the gear icon, import brushes, finally select the .abr file that you downloaded. Usually you would just go right now and start stamping the drawing with trees, right? But let me show you how to do it in advanced mode. We're going to use a solid color for each layer of trees. This allows us to control the depth of this mess of vegetation. Yeah, you could use the brush opacity to do it quickly, but then you wouldn't be able to change the strength of the trees with precision later, and that also means that it would be transparent. So, select the color fill layer mask and hit Ctrl I to invert it from white to black, therefore hiding the whole fill. Now you just gotta use the tree brushes with the white to paint over it, and repeat that as many times as you need, and I'm brightening the color in each time. See, now I still think this is too dark, but it's as simple as double clicking on each solid color fill and adjusting the values. This also ensures that no tree gets blended with the other, and we do in fact feel the depth here. And as an extra and optional step, we can even add some textures over this whole combo here. Make it very subtle though. You can use blend modes to achieve unique results. For example, soft light works really good in this situation. Now let me quickly clean some of these lines here. As you see, I'm always using masks and not erasing it with the erase tool. And now I'm going to add a background, but this is optional. It really depends on the board, presentation, or portfolio style. It can work, but also be careful about it. Again, masks to hide where necessary. And now looking at this composition, I feel that the fills, the textures that we added earlier feel a bit washed out. And a solution to this is to overlay one more texture on top of it. I really like to play with multiple textures to create unique results. And I'm taking a concrete texture from that texture pack I mentioned, and I'm using it somewhat oversized for this schematic look. Then make sure to use the multiply blend mode so that it properly blends with the texture beneath it. Lowering the opacity could also work too. Then last but definitely not least, I'm gonna add human figures so that we give this elevation scale. The silhouette of people serve the purpose of telling how big or small the building is by a glance. And you can get creative depending on who the target audience is. And if you noticed, here I'm adding as individual PNGs. I find it easier to nail the correct size by doing this way, but brushes could totally work too. A good rule of thumb that I use is that if I'm gonna add a lot of people and if the scale is big, like 1 to 500, 1 to 1000, I go with brushes. But if it's smaller, therefore if it has more detail and an enlarged drawing, I'm a bit more careful with the people's sizes and I go for individual files. And since this is a folder, I can add a solid color over it and clip it to quickly add color to the whole group of people. But for this drawing, I'm sticking with black. And that's it guys, some more overall corrections and refinement, and here it is. As always, if you have any questions, be sure to leave it in the comments below. I'll do my best to get to everyone. And if you enjoyed this type of video, our courses are even more detailed and complete. There, I can really dive deep into every step and dissect each move so that you learn a workflow in full. If you stayed until here, be sure to give this video a like. It really helps with the algorithm so that this content can reach a lot more people. And don't forget to subscribe to not miss any new videos. Thanks for watching. I'll see you guys in the next one.